Hi, and welcome to Preview. My name is Guy Giampapa. Preview.
Preview. Preview. Preview.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, cue guy.
Hello and welcome to Preview. You know, in the 1940s, Betty Hutton was one of the biggest stars on the Paramount lot. In the 1970s, her career had gone down and she was working in Rhode Island. Well, at that time, I had the privilege of talking with her, and I'd like to show you what we talked about in just a few moments, but first, let's talk about theater. Well, the 2014 Obie Award winner for Best New American Play, called Appropriate, made its New England premiere at the Speakeasy Stage Company. And within this play, 7 of the 8 actors made their Speakeasy debut. Was it a success? Oh, yes, indeed. Along with Boston favorite Melinda Lopez, these thespians gave performances that I consider top-notch. Miss Lopez stars in this drama written by Brandon Jacobs Jenkins. Appropriate tells the story of a group of siblings who gather at the crumbling mansion of their deceased father. They've come home to mourn him and to settle his estate. What is expected to go smoothly turns out to be just the opposite. Tempers flare and past issues are brought up. Miss Lopez is riveting, and she commands the stage when she performs. Brian T. Donovan as Alex Pollock are the two brothers who do not see eye to eye. While the accent is in the story, I want to mention the set design created by Christina Todesca. It's fascinating to look at the many objects she has placed on the stage. Hopefully, Ernie will consider it at award time. Appropriate is one play you should see this season. You won't regret it. And while we are discussing Speakeasy, I want to mention they will receive part of a $30 million investment to strengthen programming and organizational capacity. Speakeasy plans to use the resources from this grant to solidify the company's future by completing a rigorous strategic planning process and then implementing its findings as regards changes in the company leadership structure and management systems. Good luck, Speakeasy. A Little Night Music is considered to be Stephen Sondheim's most romantic and popular work. A Little Night Music, which opened the Huntington's 2015-16 season, is an adaptation taken from the Ingmar Bergman movie Smiles of a Summer Night. This production is beautiful and exquisitely staged by artistic director Peter Dubois. A Little Night Music is a romantic comedy with a cast of characters headed by Hayden Gwynn, who is featured as Desiree. She's a famous actress whose escapades center around a summer weekend in the country. The voices are excellent, the scenery is beautiful, and the music is what we expect from Sondheim. According to Dubois, here we have some of the most beautiful music written for the stage. You don't have to be a Sondheim fan to enjoy it. It speaks for itself. Other notables in the cast are Michaela Donovan as Petra, Pablo Torres as Henrik, and Stephen Bogardus and Morgan Kerner as Frederick and Anne. The 12-piece orchestra was under the direction of Jonathan Mastro, and the scenic designer was Derek McLean. A Little Night Music at the Huntington Theater. Well, 39 Steps. When Alfred Hitchcock filmed the 39 Steps in 1935, little did he know his mystery classic would be recreated as a fast-moving comic farce. He was quoted as saying, "What I liked about the 39 Steps were the sudden switches and the jumping from one situation to another with such rapidity." Well, he got that right. The Company Theater of Norwell has recreated this classic just as it was presented when it premiered at the Huntington Theater in Boston a few years ago. Since that time, it went on to a successful run on Broadway and is now featured at Company Theater. This production was designed and directed by R. Patrick Gallagher, and he has succeeded in bringing it to the stage. The four characters in the play are Jamie Morris as Richard Hannay, Christy Redding, who takes on the role of several women, and Jake Plummer and Christopher Spencer, as the two goons who are nothing short of hilarious in their multiple roles. The simple scenery and the costumes by James A. Valentin reflect the era in which the story takes place. Congratulations to one and all at Company Theater for their efforts in keeping the tradition of fine theater in the community. The 39 Steps is a good example of their work.
Hi, I'm Guy Giampapa, and this is the Hollywood Backlot. Tonight we've got a very, very special guest. I'm really excited about this. She's a charter member of the Fraternity of Entertainment Greats, and her name is Betty Hutton. Hi, Betty. It's so good to have you tonight.
Thank you. How do you do?
Well, we waited a long time to bring you up to Boston. And you finally made it.
Yes, about 6 months ago, I think you called me.
That's right, that was the first time. Yeah. How do you like living in New England?
Oh, I love it. I love all the people. I love the change of season. I lived in California most of my life.
Yes.
And prior to that, I came from the East, but I just love being near all the wonderful people I've met here.
You were born in the Midwest, weren't you?
Battle Creek, Michigan, where the cornflakes come from. The corn and the vitality come from Michigan.
That's your secret of success.
Right.
The corn and the vitality.
Right.
Betty, you made a lot of great movies. You made, well over 20 movies, right?
I think about 30 or so.
30,
yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And you worked with some of the greats in movies, Bing Crosby.
Bob Hope, Charlton Heston, Jimmy Stewart, yeah. Oh,
tell me about Bing Crosby.
Well, I made the picture where I played twins.
Yes, with, Here Come
with
the
Bing.
Waves.
Yeah, he was a terrific guy. His dressing room was right next to mine. And when I went there, I was only 19 years old, and he and Bob Hope kind of took me under their wing, you know, and showed me where the camera was and which way to look and not to get too excited during the takes. It's not like the theater, because I came straight from the stage and I would work too strong. You know,
That's right.
To calm it down because there's the lens real close to you, and if you come on too strong, it's no good, you know.
Was it difficult? I know you have a stage background, and you worked with Ethel Merman, and I want to talk about that.
Right.
But when you went into movies, you had no audience reaction. How did it feel?
Well, that was what was so difficult, because since 3 years old, I had been only in front of an audience. And it was very tough, you know, you look out there and they're very quiet and no one's making a sound. You think you're doing something funny and you look out and they're glaring at you. But what they're doing is seeing if the light is right and if the thing is measured correctly. But it used to drive me crazy. I couldn't make them laugh, you know. So I'd work hard to make the crew break up. Then if I could break them up, I knew I was in business. Then the director would cut. Nobody laugh, you know. So I had to get used to that, but I did.
Did you watch the rushes every night?
No, not in the beginning, because I went a couple of times and I never liked what I did.
Really?
Because it was so different, you know, from, when you're on the stage, you never see what you do. I think it kind of scared me all of a sudden to see what I was doing, you know.
I said that you had worked on the stage. You worked with Ethel Merman.
My second Broadway show was
your
with
first
Ethel
one.
Two for the
two
show.
Two for the show with Eve Arden.
Eve Arden, Keenan Wynn. Yeah, I was the star of that one, though. Overnight, I became a star in that one.
That
I was only 16 and 17. Yeah,
that's absolutely.
And then I went in a show with Ethel Merman. It was called Panama Hattie.
Yes.
And Buddy DeSilva was the producer of it, and he subsequently went to Hollywood, and became head of Paramount. Mm-hmm. But what happened was in Panama Hattie, I had one fantastic number. She was the big star, of course. I didn't have much to do, but I had one great number with Arthur Treacher. And they couldn't even write enough encores for it. And she left all the encores in, out of town, and even the opening, the benefit night before the real opening. And opening night, she took it out on me. And I was petrified. I said, Buddy, I can't go on because I have nothing to do. He said, Betty, if you go on and stick with the show for 1 year, I'll bring you to Hollywood and make you a star. And that's how it happened.
And that's how it happened.
Yeah, it's because that number was removed that night and I didn't have anything to do that was any good, you know.
That's a real Cinderella story.
Yeah,
isn't it?
It really happened that way.
You had an understudy.
June Allison.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I find that
she was in the chorus, and one night she came and she said, Betty, you know, Buddy DeSilva doesn't believe the chorus kids to understudy. Mm-hmm. But she wanted my part so badly, so I went to Buddy and said, let her be the understudy, and I would stay late at night and teach her every move. And so I got sick. I got the German measles or something once. And she went on, she was terrific. And they put her in Best Foot Forward.
Oh, my.
And she became a big star, you know, overnight. She
from
did
that,
great.
From that start.
Yes, yes.
Oh. Betty, you've been compared to Judy Garland. I know that
our stories are similar.
Yeah, you replaced her in Annie Get Your Gun.
Yes, I followed her on Broadway. I followed her after we had left movies and we were doing, you know, the nightclubs in Vegas and theater appearances. I followed her into the
Palace Theater,
and I broke all the records there. But we were very close friends. Our lives were very similar. You know, we both took too many pills to get on and too many pills to go to sleep, because that's when it had become a rat race. So that was after movies were over. And it was just too much hard work, and you couldn't do like 15 shows a day. You know, you just didn't have that kind of vitality. So you had to take a pill to have the energy. And of course, both of us got into that trap.
Of course.
Fortunately, I got out of it, but not in time, but finally in time now, you know. Then I replaced you in Annie Get Your Gun, and let's see, we were very, around Hollywood, we were close friends, though. And when I replaced her, Annie, I felt very bad because I dressed right under her. I think they did it on purpose to punish her, which was so cruel, you know. But she told me she didn't care, but I knew she did. And I tried to pacify her at the time, but she was very, very ill. As sick as I was 6 years ago, she was at that time, you know.
But your sickness was never publicized the way Judy Garland's was.
Well, because mine didn't happen during the picture career. It didn't happen until much, much later. When I was, I would say, the 20 years ago, which was way after pictures, you know.
Yes.
No, it never touched me in movies. It didn't catch up to me until my work was getting just too difficult, you know. Mm-hmm. Judy had emotional problems way ahead of that.
Yeah.
'Cause you know, when a kid is a kid star, which Judy was in movies, then it's very, very dangerous. I don't see how they can do it. That I was a star young on Broadway, but that's different.
It's a different story.
Yeah, because
really.
In movies, you know, they spoil you. They throw out the red carpet.
Yeah.
And anything you want, anything to get you on, let me put it that way. Mm-hmm. If it takes a pill or a drink, they could care less. And that's the God's truth. They don't care what you take to get on. And that's sad, because Judy was just a young kid and she was overweight, and they gave her what they call diet pills. And that's the same as speed.
Really damaged her.
Sure.
Betty, we've got to pause for a message,
okay.
But we'll be back in a moment. This is a scene from Here Come the Waves with Betty Hutton, Bing Crosby, and Sonny Tufts. Betty, this is the only picture you made with Sonny Tufts.
Yes.
He was a local boy. I mean, he was born right here in Massachusetts.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yes, he didn't hang around Hollywood. He was very wealthy in his own right, and he
yes.
just was like a playboy, and he wasn't too serious about making pictures. At least he wasn't when I knew him. And that's the only one I made with him, so I don't know him too well.
Apparently, Sonny Tufts, I don't mean this disrespectful, but he was always a big joke in Hollywood, wasn't he?
Well, yeah, they'd say, Sonny Tufts.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know what that originated from, except he used to drink a lot, you know, and we'd kind of wait on the set wondering, was he going to show up? Was that right? He wasn't serious about his career, but he was a nice guy. He just wasn't too interested in being a
yeah,
star, you know.
Too bad. Yeah. Betty, you started out with Vincent Lopez, didn't you?
Right.
As a singer. You yeah. and your sister Marion.
When I was 13.
Your wonderful yeah. sister Marion.
I won an amateur contest in Detroit, Michigan.
Yeah.
And part of the deal was that I would take my mother and my sister with me with the band, because we were dead broke, and I thought, now's the time to get us out of Michigan, you know. So I went with the band, took my sister, and then Glenn Miller was just starting out then,
yes.
and she went on one night. He came to see me, and we decided to put her on because we wanted to get her with a band. And that night she went on and she did all my numbers.
And that happened right here in Boston, didn't it?
Ritz-Carlton Roof.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes,
yeah. yeah. The Roosevelt family used to come there and see me. And you weren't allowed to sit with the customers. You know, that would show people were not
yes.
good enough. But they insisted. So my wonderful life started with them, from the real pits of the world where I came from. Their governess started to teach me how to speak English, literally, you know. And when I sat down at the table, what all the knives and forks were for. I had a really wonderful time in Boston with them.
When you sang with Vince Lopez, the reports were that the band wasn't happy with you for a while because of your clowning around.
I wasn't happy with them either.
But something happened
well,
that changed the whole picture.
I was too scared, you
yeah.
know, when I first joined them to do my style. Because I had never been in a big theater. He found me in a little dinky nightclub, you know. And I'd only performed in front of very small groups of people. And I'd get on the stage, I'd freeze. And then one night, the trombone player, Mike Durso, took me. I was going to get fired that night because I wasn't going over, and they were getting too many complaints from the management. So he gave me a B&B, a Benedictine and brandy, a little tiny.
Oh, boy.
Three. And I'd never had a drink in my life, even though I was around it, you know. And I went back on the stage, and I had a song called The Dipsy Doodle.
Yes.
Remember that?
Yes.
The Dipsy Doodle, blah, 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 blah. And I sang the chorus, and there was always 16 bars where the singer would sit down. Well, I didn't sit down. I picked Vincent up. He must have weighed a ton. And I swung around. I sat him down. I was going crazy on the stage. And that audience went wild. And I went off the stage, and Vincent came up and said, "Why didn't you do this before?" I was too scared. So from then on, the fear left, and I was able to do it without a Benedictine and Brandy.
Isn't that
and
funny?
From then on, the style was born, you know?
From that.
The
from
crazy
that, from
style.
Humble beginnings.
Right, right, yeah.
In those days, they called you America's number one jitterbug.
Yeah.
Was that true?
Well, no, I wasn't a dancer, but Walter Winchell, when he saw me at the opening of the Cosmonaut, he said, "I can't describe what she does, so we'll call her America's number one jitterbug." You know, I just moved a lot. I didn't want anybody to really catch on. I couldn't really dance.
Would have fooled me.
Yeah. So he called me the blonde bombshell, America's yes. number one jitter. The energy is what they couldn't explain, you know, because for a bow, I'd just take the big curtain and swing on it and land in the middle of the stage.
Oh,
I would do different things every night, never the same. That opening night, the Casa Mignana, Orson Welles, he had just done that crazy show that scared the world, you know. And all the marvelous stars were sitting out there, and they just thought, this crazy kid. I was only 13 years old, you know.
That's absolutely wonderful.
Yeah.
Did you know any of the other female vocalists, Peggy Lee and Doris Day and so forth?
No, I didn't know them until I went to Hollywood because Doris Day was at Warner Brothers.
Yes.
She not in the beginning, but she was like a little bit before me, so I don't really remember. She was not on Broadway, no, when I was around. Peggy Lee was in Hollywood.
Oh, yeah. Now, this is something I did not know, and I was told this just the other day, and I have to know if it's true or not. Did Doris Day actually replace you in Romance of the High Seas because of your pregnancy?
No, not at all. He was at Warner Brothers, and he wanted me for that picture. Paramount wouldn't let me go.
Oh, I see.
And so she didn't replace me. My sister auditioned for that picture
Marian.
And didn't get it, because when I couldn't do it, I told him to send for Marian. Because I felt she was very similar to me, and they tried her out, but it didn't work out. Anyway, they hired Doris Day. Now, she didn't replace me because I didn't do it. We weren't loaned out at that time.
Well, perhaps,
I wanted to do it. I really did.
Perhaps that was a bad choice of words, replace.
Well, no, that's been said before, but I never got there, so I couldn't be replaced.
Oh, that's just exciting.
Yeah.
Is your sister, Marian, still in the business?
No, she quit long. Marian didn't really like it that much. After Glenn died, he was killed,
yes.
as you know. She just didn't do anything after that. She was a wife and mother. She's in Laguna Beach in California,
oh, yes.
retired, yeah.
I'll never forget her rendition with the Modeners of Chattanooga Choo
Choo. Right, wasn't she great?
That is so classic, isn't
wonderful,
it?
Wonderful, right.
Well... you played twins in Here Come the Waves, this picture, too.
Oh, sure wasn't. Yeah. One wasn't enough. They had to have two. They made me the dramatic one and the screwball, as they called me then. Yeah.
I said earlier that you had played with a lot of top stars in Hollywood, and I want to talk for a moment about Fred Astaire.
Oh.
Tell me about him.
He's my favorite. I think of all of them. That man has talent. It's unbelievable, because he can take someone like me who had never danced. And in that picture, we rehearsed maybe 6 months for that epic dance I had to
yes.
do. He just, it was so patient and so kind and fun. And he'd always keep his hat on because he didn't have a lot of hair, you know. And I'd always kid him about that. So one day, I always wore yarn in my hair for rehearsal. And he had just a few hairs on it. So one day I came out, I was kidding about that. They always had me to wear his hat. He took it off, and with the hairs he had, he had taken the red ribbon and tied on each one for me. Marvelous, marvelous man. I loved him.
He said something very nice about you, and I wrote it down here, and I'd like to repeat it. He complimented you by saying, "Working with Betty keeps anybody moving. She's so talented and conscientious that if you don't watch yourself, you feel you're standing still and letting her do all the work."
Oh,
that's a tribute from a
great
man.
Thank you, Guy. I didn't know he said that. Well, thank you very much. It's nice to know.
Betty, we're going to break for a commercial here, but we'll be back in just a moment.
Okay.
That's Betty Hutton with Fred McMurray in a feature called "And the Angels Sing." Fred McMurray, I think everybody knows who he is, but tell us something about him.
They ought to by now. Well, he's a very shy man.
Is he really?
Yes. I lived near him in Brentwood before I made that picture, and his wife was very, very ill and died.
His first wife?
Yes, yes. Very early. They had two children, then she died. It was very tragic. He was very quiet and reticent to speak, but a wonderful, wonderful person to work with. But he kind of didn't say much. He was sad. At the time I worked with him, he was quite sad.
He remarried. He remarried June Haver.
He's had a wonderful marriage and a happy life, because we were all pulling for him to pull out of that, and it took her to come along, you know.
Isn't that wonderful? Betty, there were two other stars in that movie. Dorothy L'Amour.
Oh, she was a wonderful person. She is.
She is.
Yeah. We're speaking the past tense of everybody here. Pretty soon, she was a nice kid. Diana Lynn, who died. That's what I was thinking about. Yeah. And who else? I don't remember who else was in that picture.
I can't recall who else was in that.
No.
Who's that? They are, again.
Oh, that's the director, isn't it? Yeah, it's George Marshall.
Is that George Marshall?
I think it is, yeah.
I'm not sure. It almost looks like Walter Brennan, but I know it isn't.
No, it's not Walter. I think it's George Marshall directing us, yeah.
This, of course, was one of your early movies.
Right. This is before I was a star. That picture and the one with Bing, I was just being featured then.
What picture made you a star in your mind?
Incendiary Blonde, I think.
That was the Texas Guinan story.
Right. Right.
Isn't that the picture you sang, It Had to Be You?
Right, It Had to Be You.
Oh, Betty, how many times did I listen to that record?
Yeah, it was good. I liked it.
Absolutely beautiful.
And then I did The Perils of Pauline.
Yes.
Those two really made me a star.
You were becoming known as the queen of the biography movies.
Right, and doing everybody's life story.
Yes. I think Hollywood had some other stories planned for you. Clara Bow, Sophie Tucker, Mabel Normand.
Yes. Well, see, what happened was with the advent of television, and Buddy DeSilva, who brought me there, had a heart attack. No one else knew what to do with me. And if I hadn't gotten Annie at that time, Annie Get Your Gun, and The Greatest Show on Earth with Cecil B. DeMille, those were outside of Paramount, I would probably have gone sooner because, well, I left my contract because they didn't have any good scripts for me. The ones you're speaking of, Buddy had in work, but no one knew what to do with him. But himself.
Yes.
And that was the tragedy, I think, of my picture career. He was the only one who knew what to do with me, because I had kind of a unique talent that had to be, you know, handled just right.
Betty, there's no question that Cecil B. DeMille was a perfectionist, and no one knows that better than you do.
He was the perfectionist. You know, when I got that picture, everybody on the lot said, wow, when those two meet head on, it's going to be murder. Because I was supposed to be very, very temperamental. But what I really was a perfectionist. So was DeMille. We got along like two peas in a pod, you know, because he was such a marvelous director. And almost everything he did, he wanted to win an award. He'd never won the Academy Award, and because he'd always done his pictures kind of corny, but very commercial. So he said to me, Betty, what do you think I should do, you know, to get this critic's acclaim? I said, well, I think, and they always say you do corny movies, but he makes millions with them, as you know. I said, the circus is corny. So, you know, you don't have to sweat it. Just cool,
with
you know.
Ballyhoo all
and he way. Got the Academy Award. He sent me a 10-page telegram when he got that award. I was very, very proud of that. Yeah.
Cecil B. DeMille, it's been said about, not about Cecil B. DeMille, but about Betty Hutton, that she wanted that role so badly.
Yes.
She sent a spray of flowers, an enormous spray of flowers.
It was as big as a studio.
Was it really?
Well, you know, when I didn't know which part, he wouldn't tell me which part was Holly and the other part, which was the star of the piece. And after I had my interview with him, I ran to the florist, and I had this big circus ring made, and I had an elephant, you know, not a real one, put in, and a trapeze. And a blonde doll on each, and I merely said, "Dear Mr. DeMille, my future rests in your hands. Which shall it be?" And so he said, "She's a showman. I'm going to give her the lead." So I got the picture.
And you got the lead.
Yeah.
Oh, that is a great story.
He was a great man. Yeah.
Do you have any plans to go back into movies?
Well, anyone who says that they don't really love it and want it back are crazy. But when you get to be my age, you can't have that piece of cake any longer. I enjoyed it. I'm grateful to my audience for everything that happened to me. And now I have found God, and I'm very, very happy right here in New England. But I might be doing commercials or on shows like this, and I'm doing speaking things, trying to help people that maybe have my kind of power, or did have, rather. And I'm speaking around the country, and I'm having a very good time.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
You are a person without ego. I really have to say that.
Oh, thank
I have never
you,
met
God.
Another person like you. Your energies are to help people. I just can't say enough, Betty.
Thank you very much, Guy.
This has been a marvelous experience for all of us.
This is a blessed station. I really appreciate being here. God bless you.
Well, thank you
very
much. I think
thank you.
Everyone from Pat Robertson down would love to hear that.
Thank you very much.
I will personally relay that to him.
Okay, Guy. Thank you so much for this wonderful interview.
We're going to break now, but we're coming back in just a moment. Betty, it's been a real pleasure. I have to say that again because I'm very excited about this interview tonight.
Thank you very
much. Will you please come back sometime?
I certainly will, anytime you want me.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Friends, this is Guy Giampapa on the Hollywood Backlot. Next week, we'll be back with another great motion picture for your entertainment. Now, that's on the WXNE-TV Hollywood Backlot each and every Saturday night at 6:30 p.m. Have yourself a very pleasant evening. Good night now.